Well, friends, welcome. We're going to get started. It is so wonderful to see you this evening. My name is Jeff Hunt. I have the wonderful privilege of serving as the director of the Centennial Institute here at Colorado Christian University. And this is one of our monthly president's lectures. And I'm filling in for Dr. Sweeting this evening. Today, we're going to be discussing, in honor of President's Day, coming up, Dwight D. Eisenhower. Now, Dr. Mark Grotlucian will speak on the life of General Dwight D. Eisenhower, the 34th President of the United States. General Eisenhower also served as the President of Columbia College. Did you know that? A President of a university and went on to be the President of the United States. I think we'd like to see that here at Colorado Christian University, wouldn't we? He was the Chief of Staff of the Army and Supreme Allied Commander of Europe. He was responsible for planning the successful invasion of Normandy, one of the most important military moments in our American history. As a military historian, Dr. Grotlucian is eminently qualified to speak about President Eisenhower's spiritual life and the overall importance of his service to our country. Now, President's Day is in about a week. It's a week from today. And so this is an important discussion as we highlight the impact the presidents have had on our country. Mark Grotlucian is a PhD, teaches strategic studies in the Department of Military and Strategic Studies at the U.S. Air Force Academy near Colorado Springs, Colorado. For those of you that may be watching, we're very proud of the Air Force Academy here in Colorado. They do wonderful work and raise up a great generation of soldiers for our country. He previously served as professor of history while holding a senior military faculty position in the Department of History. During more than a decade of teaching at the U.S. Air Force Academy, he has taught on a wide range of courses covering history, strategy, military thought, statesmanship, and area studies. He is the recipient of the Academy's Outstanding Academy Educator Award, the McDermott Award for Research Excellence in the Humanities, and the Orison Award for Cadet Advising and Mentoring. A 27-year Air Force veteran with numerous overseas deployments, he has served as a squadron commander, a headquarters staff officer, and as a United Nations peacekeeper as part of the UN mission in Liberia. He graduated with academic distinction from the U.S. Air Force Academy, earned an MA in military and diplomatic history from the University of Calgary, and holds a PhD in history from Texas A&M University. He's the author or editor of many articles, chapters, and books, including The AEF Way of War, The American Army and Combat in World War I, which has been selected repeatedly by multiple U.S. Army Chiefs of Staff for their professional reading lists. Most recently, he authored Into the Fight, April through June 1918, for the U.S. Army Center of Military History's Campaign of World War I series, and has edited Volume 2 of the Harmon Memorial Lectures in Military 1988 to 2017. He is currently writing a biography on Eisenhower for Oxford University Press. We're very grateful to have him with us. Now, I was doing some research on Dwight D. Eisenhower, came across a book that he had written just after he had left office called At Ease, Stories I Tell Friends. Like 400 pages, I guess, of stories he shared with friends and colleagues and little anecdotes. I came across this one story that really helped shape Dwight D. Eisenhower's personality when it came to bullies, which was important. We had dinner, talked about how America responds to bullies. Well, how did Dwight D. Eisenhower learn about bullies? Well, he grew up in rural parts of this country and was about 6 years old when he attended a family reunion. Now, there was no kids his age. And so he's kind of wandering around this farm looking for things to do, and he came across this big male turkey. And the male turkey got its wings all big and chased after him, and young Dwight D. Eisenhower is only 6 years old, takes off running back into the house. And he goes back out. Again, that turkey's there, puffs big up and chases after Dwight D. Eisenhower, and Dwight D. Eisenhower runs back into the house. This happens about 6 or 7 times. Finally, General Eisenhower's uncle gives him a broom, and he says, the next time that turkey acts like that, you whack him with your broom. And so the turkey puffs up big, and Dwight D. Eisenhower again grabs his broom, and instead of running off, he hits the turkey on the back The stunned turkey doesn't know what to do and backs off. And that was how Dwight D. Eisenhower, I guess, learned how to deal with bullies. Now, another interesting anecdote, you know we pardon turkeys as presidents right now. That didn't happen until Ronald Reagan. Dwight D. Eisenhower, I guess, ate his two turkeys. So, friends, let's please welcome Mark Grotlucian as he gives us a presentation today on Dwight D. Eisenhower. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff, for that introduction. Dwight learned how to take care of bullies at a young age. It probably didn't make his pacifist mother very happy if he was whacking the turkey, but probably showed that he was going to be a great soldier someday. So I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to speak with you tonight, especially because it means I've successfully navigated the I-25 gap construction. So I really am glad to safely be here tonight. Whether you're here in the room with me at the Anschutz Student Center or watching the video feed from your dorm room, office, apartment, or home, I thank you for taking some time this evening to learn more about one of our countries, and I think it's not unreasonable to say one of the world's greatest modern leaders, Dwight D. Eisenhower. At this time, both here in the United States and even abroad as well, when people are tearing down statues of persons previously deemed to be great, I suspect it's worth beginning by asking whether, in fact, it's appropriate to lift up any historical figure and declare that he or she is worthy of being so honored. None of them has been perfect. Our history, our theology, and even our own experience of so-called good and great people in our day make this point clear. And of course, this is true for Dwight Ike Eisenhower as well. Eisenhower was a flawed man, a flawed general, and a flawed political leader. And I could spend all of my time tonight discussing Eisenhower's flaws, faults, and failures. But the founders of this lecture series believe, rightly, I think, that we might nevertheless benefit from looking at some of these admittedly flawed leaders, seeing the good that they accomplished, and examining how they achieved so much. We should especially be willing to do the hard work of exploring what it was about them, their character, their personality. We might say their heart, mind, soul, and strength that enabled them to achieve so much. In doing so, we might better understand not only why such individuals are worth honoring, but why they are worth emulating. This is, in fact, the path I intend to take in tonight's talk. First, to briefly discuss Eisenhower's remarkable accomplishments, and second, to examine his inner character, the source of his greatness. To be clear, I am not going to offer a full biography of Eisenhower's long and full life. There are plenty of 600-page or longer biographies out there. Some cover only his presidential years in those 600 pages. A few spend over 800 pages discussing just his military career. Of course, there are shorter bios, and as you well know, Wikipedia, to step you through the strict chronology and events of his life. But tonight, I will discuss a few of Eisenhower's major achievements and then cover something none of those 600 or 800-page biographies really get into, the foundation and source of Eisenhower's personality, his convictions, and his worldview. So what's so special about Eisenhower? What were his great achievements? Why did so many people then and now like Ike? As the father of 5 children, ranging in age from 12 to 24, and perhaps more relevant, as a college professor of undergraduate students myself, I know that I should not presume that tonight's audience of CCU undergraduate students possess either a deep or broad knowledge about Eisenhower's life and career. I suspect it's safer to assume that most people listening to this presentation know very little about him or his accomplishments. After all, he achieved fame during World War II some 75 years ago, and then served as U.S. president for 2 terms in the 1950s. Which means he left public office some 60 years ago. Anyone my age and older has a distinct advantage here, as Eisenhower left office just 9 years before my birth. A better comparison for my generation and those older might be to try to remember what we knew when we were 21 years old about, say, General John Pershing, America's senior overseas commander in the First World War, or such now distant political leaders as Woodrow Wilson, Warren G. Harding, or Calvin Coolidge. I suspect very few of us would have impressed anyone with our knowledge of those significant officials from our country's First World War and then its subsequent decade in the 1920s. I mention this so explicitly for two reasons. To warn the older faculty and staff members listening that much of what I will say tonight, especially in the first part of my talk, may seem like common knowledge to those in our generation. I beg your indulgence, and I trust you nevertheless will learn something of value in my remarks, unless the audience is filled with a group of Eisenhower scholars. Secondly, I want to let the CCU students know that I don't expect them to know a great deal about Eisenhower. I can assure you that most people from my generation still don't know much about John Pershing or Calvin Coolidge. And if I convince you to spend some time learning more about Eisenhower on your own, that will be a very good thing. And I do believe we all ought to know more about Dwight Eisenhower, and especially about his contributions to our country and even to the entire world. He was in many ways a thoroughly normal, common American man, but he accomplished extraordinary things in very challenging times. In fact, he achieved these remarkable successes with a grace and humility that have at times caused observers to undervalue the trials he overcame and the impact of his influence on those events. So who was Ike Eisenhower? And why should every American know more about him and his achievements? In short, Dwight D. Eisenhower is arguably the greatest soldier statesman of the 20th century. He was first a soldier, a graduate of the U.S. Military Academy at West Point in the class of 1915. He spent most of the 18 months of American belligerency in World War I training new, inexperienced soldiers how to fight with tanks, a truly cutting-edge technology in 1918. He also spent those months trying, unsuccessfully, to get himself over to the American Expeditionary Forces then fighting on the Western Front in Europe. He was a fantastic organizer and trainer of troops, apparently too good to be sent to fight overseas. But he feared that failing to get over to France and take part in the fighting, as so many colleagues did, might ruin his career. He then spent the next 20 years serving in obscurity, preparing himself, the army, and the country for its next great war. Service in the interwar army was tough duty, with long hours, low pay that got even lower when the federal government cut military pay during the Great Depression, and with little chance of promotion. Eisenhower served in the rank of major for 16 years. The current standard is about 4 to 5 years for a major in the U.S. Army today. Even though he worked for many of the most famous and high-ranking officers in the Army, such as Fox Connor, John Pershing, and Douglas MacArthur. But, providentially, his great efforts at personal and professional preparation were not in vain. While just a lieutenant colonel when World War II began, his remarkable talents and abilities proved to be in high demand, and he was rapidly promoted from lieutenant colonel, to brigadier general, to major general, to lieutenant general, to four-star general, in less than 2 years. Almost immediately after American entry into World War II, Eisenhower began working in the headquarters of the U.S. Army, planning the global American war effort for the wartime chief of staff, General George C. Marshall, who increasingly recognized Eisenhower's special aptitude, trustworthiness, and personality. Within just a few months, Marshall sent Eisenhower to command all Americans in the European theater, and then appointed him to command the first combined American and British attack into Axis-occupied territory in North Africa in 1942 and 43. After clearing all Italian and German forces out of North Africa, he then planned and commanded the attack and occupation of Sicily, as well as the initial invasion of the Italian mainland. His successes convinced President Franklin Roosevelt, with Prime Minister Winston Churchill's full support, to name him as commander of all forces in the Grand Alliance in the European theater, American, British, Canadian, Polish, and French. His effective management of the European theater of operations included, most famously, the successful invasion of Normandy, France, on D-Day in Operation Overlord. Some of you have seen, perhaps, Saving Private Ryan, the 1998 film, or the 2001 miniseries Band of Brothers, which depict that invasion. That attack, involving hundreds of thousands of men, over 11,000 aircraft and more than 6,000 ships, was one of the largest and certainly the most complicated of military operations in all of human history. It was also one of the most risky, especially considering the horrible weather in the days surrounding the attack on the 6th of June, 1944. Success, so critical to the defeat of Nazi Germany, was no foregone conclusion. Before the attack, Britain's chief of the Imperial General Staff wrote in his diary, "I am very uneasy about the whole operation. At best, it will fall so very short of the expectation of the bulk of the people. At worst, it may well be the most ghastly disaster of the whole war." Winston Churchill, who had witnessed failed attacks as a battalion commander on the Western Front in World War I, and who had seen his own brainchild of a massive coalition amphibious invasion at Gallipoli end in senseless slaughter, told Eisenhower, "When I think of the beaches of Normandy choked with the flowers of American and British youth, and when in my mind's eye I see the tides running red with their blood, I have my doubts. I have my doubts, Ike. I have my doubts." For his own part, on the day before the attack, a burdened Eisenhower admitted, "I hope to God I know what I'm doing." And then he took the time to handwrite a brief, in case of failure, press release, announcing the failure of the attack, accepting all responsibility for it, and praising the troops for doing all that could have been done. One respected German historian, a former German admiral, no less, rated Eisenhower's bold decision to attack during the brief break in the bad weather one of the truly great decisions in military history. But that brilliant success, a product in part of many specific controversial command decisions made by Eisenhower, only put Allied forces onto the continent. Then, his armies, which ultimately grew to more than 4 million men, repeatedly defeated more experienced German forces throughout France, Belgium, the Netherlands, and Germany itself. And they did so in ways that attempted to minimize Allied casualties, in contrast to the massive campaigns of the Soviet forces beating back the Germans on the Eastern Front, where victories typically were achieved with atrocious human losses. Eisenhower's ability to keep the Allied armies working together was truly an extraordinary feat of military leadership. He routinely demonstrated statesmanship of the highest order, especially when we remember some of the difficult personalities he had to work with, such as Winston Churchill, the Free French leader Charles de Gaulle, the senior British commander Bernard Montgomery, and the mercurial American Army commander George S. Patton. At a distance of 75 years, we may be tempted to take for granted the creation of a truly integrated coalition war effort, and even more so, the maintenance of that Allied effort throughout the twists and turns of events and the strategic and operational disagreements that accompany coalition operations.
Eisenhower deserves credit for the organizational creation and the functional success of his command in Europe. One study on the topic concludes that the truly Allied command never would have worked without Eisenhower, for he virtually invented the concept of Allied unity of command and persuaded the British to accept it in lieu of the committee system to which they were accustomed. After receiving the German surrender, General Marshall, a reserved man, not given to hyperbole or flattery, sent a congratulatory message to Eisenhower that stated, "You have completed your mission with the greatest victory in the history of warfare. You have commanded with outstanding success the most powerful military force that has ever been assembled. You have made history, great history, for the good of mankind." Indeed, Eisenhower's accomplishments had not only made great history, they made him an international hero. He was celebrated from London to New York to Abilene, Kansas, his hometown. But Eisenhower had no desire to be a celebrity. He understood the honors heaped upon him were really meant for everyone in the war effort, including his entire command. And he said so repeatedly. When he was feted in London, he said, "Humility must always be the portion of any man who receives acclaim earned in the blood of his followers and the sacrifices of his friends." He took every opportunity to give honor and praise to others, from his superiors, FDR and Churchill, whom he called the two God-given men who were his joint commanders-in-chief, to the members of his own staff and principal commanders, of whom he said he had often thanked a kind providence, to his battle leaders, of whom he asserted that, without exception, their first care has been for the welfare, spiritual and physical, of their men, to the workers on the home front, who he said shared a spiritual unity with the troops at the front. After rejecting immediate offers of support for any political aspirations he might have after the war, Eisenhower initiated the successful Allied occupation of the defeated and destroyed Axis countries, then returned to the U.S. to serve as the Chief of Staff of the U.S. Army from late 1945 to 1948, in which capacity he had to manage the challenge of the largest military demobilization in American history, all while the Cold War was emerging. He then took a leave of absence from the Army, five-star generals never officially retired, to serve as president of Columbia University in 1948. Eisenhower led the university through a challenging period of change and growth and left it in excellent shape in terms of student and faculty enrollment, curriculum, and financial health. He initiated such innovative programs as the Institute of War and Peace Studies, the American Assembly, which was a gathering of academics, businessmen, and labor leaders who looked for ways to protect democracy from its enemies. And finally, a citizen education project, because Eisenhower believed that every student who comes to this place must leave it first a better citizen and only second a better scholar. From late 1950 to mid-1952, Eisenhower took a leave of absence from his duties at Columbia to fulfill President Truman's request that he return to active service with the Army and become the first Supreme Allied Commander of Europe for the new NATO alliance. In this position, which Ike called the most important military job in the world, he had to assess the threat posed by the Communist bloc and the potential capabilities of the new NATO alliance in order to determine what kinds of forces could be assembled, as well as how they ought to be organized and led. He then traveled throughout the initial 12 NATO countries to encourage their populations and governments to make the required commitments. With the Korean War raging in East Asia, The challenges of creating a sufficient military command in Europe to deter and, if necessary, defeat a communist attack on the free world were more than just theoretical. Still reeling from the traumas of World War II, Eisenhower's initial tour of NATO countries noted the weakness, almost the defenselessness, of Western Europe. But he also saw what he called the spiritual vigor of the people, who were struggling to rebuild their societies, finding in NATO a new hope in their fight against the creeping paralysis of communism. While in Europe, many prominent Americans, including politicians, businessmen, and religious figures, visited Eisenhower and attempted to convince him to seek the nomination of the Republican Party for president in the 1952 election. After refusing the call to enter politics for the previous 7 years, he let the petitioners convince him that his country needed him. To end the virtual one-party rule that had dominated the federal government since 1933, to clean up Washington, D.C. They didn't say drain the swamp, but that's what they were thinking. And to ensure that America maintained its position as the fully engaged leader of the free world. Eisenhower agreed to run, returned from Europe, left the active duty army, and won the 1952 election in a landslide. As president-elect, he traveled to Korea to learn more about the war there firsthand. Within 6 months of his first term, he successfully brought the fighting there to an end, perhaps by threatening to expand the war. For a nation and a world that was beginning to fear that the fighting in Korea might drone on interminably, this was a major achievement. During his 2 terms as president, he led the U.S. through 8 years of peace and prosperity. He successfully kept the country out of war, especially in Southeast Asia, while simultaneously resisting communist expansion and attempting to reduce Cold War tensions with the Soviet Union, a tough path to navigate. But Eisenhower was committed both to human freedom and to preserving peace. As he later said, he hated war as only a soldier who has lived it can. Only as one who has seen its brutality, its futility, its stupidity. And as a president, he announced that the pursuit of peace is at once our religious obligation and our national policy. His domestic achievements were equally impressive. While maintaining a conservative view of constitutional authority, he has only recently been receiving credit for his important actions in advancing the cause of civil rights. In his first inaugural address, he spoke of the abiding creed of our fathers, our faith in the deathless dignity of man, governed by eternal moral and natural laws, which established beyond debate those gifts of the Creator that are man's inalienable rights, and that make all men equal in his sight. And to be clear, he explicitly noted that this equality existed regardless of station, race, or calling. He even connected this conviction with the great moral struggle of the Cold War by stating, "Any man who seeks to deny equality among all his brothers betrays the spirit of the free and invites the mockery of the tyrant." In office, he hired a pro-civil rights attorney general, desegregated Washington, D.C., including its schools, as well as all federal agencies, completed desegregation of the U.S. military, and appointed pro-civil rights judges at all levels of the federal judiciary, including the Supreme Court. He worked with political figures and religious leaders to encourage voluntary desegregation at the state and local levels throughout the South. And when state authorities in Little Rock, Arkansas, refused to abide by the Supreme Court's decision to desegregate schools, he sent in the 101st Airborne Division to ensure that the law was peacefully enforced. He also shepherded through Congress the first Civil Rights Act since Reconstruction. These were impressive achievements. He also secured funding for the country's massive interstate highway system that we all drive on, ensured steady growth of the American economy along with rising worker income, and he successfully balanced the budget multiple times despite having to deal with Democrat control of Congress. When his second term ended, he left office with strong public approval ratings, 60%. For comparison, Truman had left office with an approval rating of just 30%. Of course, Eisenhower had his detractors during and after office, especially among the political, journalistic, and academic elite. Less than 2 years after leaving office, the famous Harvard historian Arthur Schlesinger Jr. asked a group of 75 historians to rank the American presidents. They ranked Eisenhower 22nd out of just 31, placing him behind Chester Arthur, there's a name most of us don't think of very often, and just ahead of the impeached Andrew Johnson. He was well below his predecessor, Truman, and even below the previous Republican president, Herbert Hoover, who had been saddled with blame for the Great Depression. In sum, while most of the people still liked Ike, many of the elite did not. The common critique was that he was an overly traditional, indecisive, do-nothing president who spent his time grinning and cussing while golfing, painting, fishing, often here in Colorado, and playing bridge. However, as the years have gone by, and as historians and other scholars have looked closer at Eisenhower's record, they have found more reason to appreciate his achievements. In C-SPAN's 2017 Presidential Historian Survey, Eisenhower was rated 5th behind Lincoln, Washington, FDR, and Teddy Roosevelt. Regarding his generalship in World War II, Russell Weigley, one of America's greatest military historians, ranked Eisenhower among the top 3 military commanders in all of American history. In the elite top group with 2 other soldier statesmen, Ulysses Grant and George Washington. While these rankings may tell us much more about those doing the voting as about Eisenhower, the fact remains that an appreciation for Eisenhower's significance and his accomplishments has been on the rise for many years. If you agree with me now, and an increasing number of others, that Eisenhower was a special man and arguably even a great man, then perhaps you will also agree with me that it's worth asking what enabled him to be such a man, such a leader, and achieve so much. What was at the core of Eisenhower's being? What was the foundation of his beliefs and worldview? Where was the center of his personality? Despite nearly 75 years of interest and investigation into Eisenhower and his achievements, we are only just now beginning to ask those questions. Of course, the answer is going to be complicated. It must include an assessment of his impressive intelligence, his great work ethic, his ever-increasing knowledge of the military profession, his generally good-natured disposition, his courage to speak his mind to peers and superiors alike, his understanding of human nature, and his related ability, honed via lifelong study and activity, to include playing cards, to understand the minds and emotions of others, and perhaps especially his personal charisma and winsomeness. Ike's difficult British subordinate, Bernard Montgomery, said of him that his real strength lies in his human qualities. He has the power of drawing the hearts of men toward him as a magnet attracts the bit of metal. He has merely to smile at you, and you trust him at once. But if we want to understand the man and the leader, we must move beyond those important external traits and be willing to look deeply into his mind, heart, and soul and be honest about what we find there. The answer to those questions, from my perspective, comes from Eisenhower's firm biblical view of humanity and human nature and his strong faith in the God of the Bible. And this core of Eisenhower's being is the part of him that we have least understood thus far. Now, I don't want to spend too much time describing the historiography of Eisenhower's religious and spiritual life. Historiography is a fancy academic word that means what historians have written about a given topic. But for you to understand the surprising nature of what I'm going to tell you tonight about the core of Eisenhower's being, you need to know just a bit about what his leading biographers, many of them excellent historians, have written about it. Now, to be fair, the fullness of Eisenhower's professional life and accomplishments as a soldier and a statesman means that biographers have had a great deal to cover when describing Eisenhower's life and times. Perhaps because of this, no leading biographer has given sufficient attention to Eisenhower's spiritual life, despite the remarkable fact that he is still the only president to be baptized while in office. His major biographers, those who have written multi-volume or 600-page single-volume biographies, generally have either ignored, minimized, or mischaracterized his religious practices and his spiritual beliefs. None of them, despite their great detail in other areas, have adequately captured what Eisenhower himself referred to as his deeply felt spiritual convictions or his increasingly active religious life. When they do mention his religious life in their accounts, they typically present it as a form of political expediency, or at best, a politically motivated effort to lead the country, by example, back to some kind of religious-based morality. While there may be some elements of truth in those interpretations, they fail to tell the full story. Of his major biographers, only one refers to Eisenhower's baptism early in his first term, and only after asserting that Eisenhower heeded political advice and joined the Presbyterian Church. Now, it is true that a number of friends advised Eisenhower to join a church, but those recommendations came before and during his first presidential campaign, and some of the friends suggested that he join a church in order to win votes. Eisenhower refused to even consider doing such a thing, and he only joined a church after his first inauguration in 1953. None of these major biographers mentioned the week of religious instruction he and his wife Mamie accomplished with the presiding Presbyterian minister, Reverend Edward Elson, which culminated in clear affirmations of a thoroughly Orthodox Christian faith and, in addition to the baptism, a commitment to official church membership and regular attendance at National Presbyterian Church in Washington, D.C. When these biographers mention Eisenhower's standard practice of beginning cabinet meetings with a prayer, often silent, occasionally spoken, they focus on the humorous and oft-told story of the time he supposedly opened the meeting and accidentally went straight into business. When reminded by an aide, or in some versions, and the versions always differ, by his Secretary of State that he had inadvertently skipped the prayer, Ike reportedly exclaimed, "Gosh darn it," but he didn't say "gosh darn it," if you know what I mean. "We forgot the silent prayer." This story is commonly told in a way that suggests Eisenhower's faith was superficial at best and only for show at worst, with the added unstated assumption that no true Christian would ever forget to pray or use vulgar language, not to mention want to play golf or go fishing on a Sunday. None of the leading biographers discuss Eisenhower's remarkably consistent church attendance in D.C. or his financial support of his local congregation. They ignore that he typically attended church even while away at his regular vacation spots in Augusta, Georgia, Denver, Colorado, where Mamie was from, Palm Desert, California. And that he not only continued to attend church after he left office and retired to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, but that he became an active member at Gettysburg Presbyterian, and that he had gotten to know each of the pastors at those churches. His pastors in D.C. and in Gettysburg each accomplished substantial oral histories which attest to the meaningfulness of his faith. Beyond these formal relationships, Eisenhower maintained a lengthy and more than cordial relationship with Billy Graham, which began when Ike was serving as NATO's supreme commander, and continued until his death. Billy Graham's detailed retelling of his deathbed spiritual discussion with Eisenhower is particularly compelling. These ministers uniformly testify to the reality of Eisenhower's Christian faith and the sincerity of his religious belief. The inability or unwillingness of these major biographers, among others, to recognize, understand, and appreciate Eisenhower's religious life and spiritual beliefs have led many other historians and writers to mischaracterize Eisenhower's convictions. For example, in one Bancroft Prize-winning survey of modern American history, the distinguished author criticizes Eisenhower for what he determined was a superficial piety, and for supposedly making what the author believes to have been one of his most fatuous yet apparently popular utterances: "Our government makes no sense unless it is founded on a deeply felt religious faith, and I don't care what it is." More on this in just a few minutes. In another important account, a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist and historian includes this inaccurate comment: "By the way, Eisenhower was not religious. Although his parents had read the Bible each morning and evening, Eisenhower is the only man who's been elected to the American presidency without belonging to a church." Another journalist and best-selling author wrote that Eisenhower went to church mostly for appearances. He added that Eisenhower believed the president should set an example. Besides, a lot of voters, particularly Republicans, were regular churchgoers. A popular British biographer dismisses Eisenhower's 1953 baptism as an action merely to set an example. This is a curious claim, since Eisenhower's personal diary shows his great frustration with Reverend Elson's publicity efforts surrounding the event. Other writers have been more critical of Eisenhower's religious speech and actions, essentially suggesting Eisenhower's personal faith was hollow and that he crassly used religion for political or cultural reasons. In sum, the major biographers and many other writers have typically ignored Eisenhower's religious words and deeds unless they have chosen to criticize or minimize them. However, some recent scholars and writers have begun to correct this mischaracterization, and I consider myself to be one small part of this important shift in our understanding of this great American. These writers have not only recognized Eisenhower's significant role as a religious leader during his presidential years, but they have treated his spiritual life with greater respect and seriousness. Other writers are beginning to follow this trend, to include two book-length popular studies of Eisenhower's faith, just published in 2019. We are doing this because the closer one looks at the evidence of Eisenhower's words and deeds, the clearer it becomes that Eisenhower was indeed just what he said he was, a very religious man. We might even say, looking at the last decades of his life, that he was an increasingly religious man, a praying, worshiping, Bible-focused Christian. We see Eisenhower's close acquaintance with religious groups and movements, such as the National Association of Evangelicals, and his support of such then-new initiatives as the National Prayer Breakfast, originally held in 1953, his first year in office, and called the Presidential Prayer Breakfast. His signing of the Statement of Seven Divine Freedoms, based on the 23rd Psalm, as well as the adding of "Under God" to the Pledge of Allegiance, and "In God We Trust" onto all U.S. currency. Most importantly, Eisenhower's own words, published and unpublished, suggest not only that he possessed and confessed serious spiritual beliefs in the Protestant Christian tradition and lived a more devoutly religious life than many historians have acknowledged, but also that his beliefs and practices significantly impacted his personal activities, his political views, and his policy goals. While much of this becomes clearer during and after the presidential years, glimpses of this can be seen even before those eras. In fact, we see it right from the start of Eisenhower's life, when his parents raised him and his five brothers in a busy, happy, hardworking, and extraordinarily religious home. Bella Kornitzer, who wrote a book on the five living Eisenhower boys in the 1950s, claimed that the home of the Eisenhower boys was a church or house of worship as much as it was a place in which the family worked, ate, played, or slept. The family often went to the local River Brethren Church, that's a Mennonite sect, but they also regularly gathered with friends and neighbors to pray, sing, and to read and discuss the Bible at home. Ike's eldest brother, Arthur, said that religion was a part of the air we breathed. And his youngest brother, Milton, said that both his parents quoted freely and constantly from the Bible. They both had a sublime faith in God and in his teachings. Prayer and Bible reading were daily family activities, and by the time he left for West Point, young Dwight had read the Bible through at least twice. Years later, when discussing his lack of church attendance and affiliation, Eisenhower explained that he was raised in a devoutly religious home, but one that stressed that a person did not have to join a church in order to be a believing Christian. Those are his words. This point cannot be stressed too strongly. As adults, the Eisenhower boys, including Dwight, stressed that the religious and spiritual dimensions of their childhood provided the solid foundation for their full, successful, and spiritually satisfying lives, regardless of their formal affiliations to specific congregations or denominations. At West Point, Ike was required to attend chapel services, which one suspects were rather more formal than his worship experiences back in Abilene, Kansas, and apparently not as satisfying. As he bounced between Army assignments from Texas to Georgia to Pennsylvania to Panama to Paris to the Philippines, he did not pick up the habit of regular church attendance. Once in Manila, when General MacArthur chided him for not going to church, Eisenhower supposedly replied that he had gone to chapel enough at West Point for the rest of his life. Winston Churchill said something similar at one point. However, it appears, both from his own contemporary words and deeds as well as his own subsequent testimony, that Eisenhower's experience in World War II drew him back towards a more open identification with the faith of his childhood. In the fall of 1943, while serving as the senior American commander in the European theater, he issued a statement for the American Bible Society, wishing it the most complete success in its purpose of holding a universal Bible Sunday. He admitted that the longer one lives close to the turmoil and sacrifice of the battlefield, the more he becomes conscious of the eternal worth of the spiritual values inherent in the Christian religion. He added that he stood ever ready to assist, and if this letter can help you in any way, you are at liberty to use it as you see fit. In November 1943, on the first anniversary of the Allied landings in North Africa, Eisenhower issued a personal message to all men and women in the North African theater, which included the assertion that all of us salute with reverence the memory of the comrades we have lost, as we earnestly pray that Almighty God will bring comfort to their loved ones. He added the claim that our allies march forward with us. The God of justice fights on our side. His famous D-Day message to the troops in June 1944 closed with the words, "And let us all beseech the blessing of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking." Now, taken in isolation, it is, of course, possible that Eisenhower was either superficially or even cynically using religion for the war effort. However, when placed in the context of Eisenhower's religious upbringing, his never disputed knowledge of and respect for the Bible, his many subsequent professions of faith in God, and his growing commitment to live an increasingly devout life as a Christian layman, these statements take on a deeper character. Eisenhower himself admitted that his experiences in the war affected his faith. Hence, his assertion that I had just made, offered you above, regarding the longer one lives close to the turmoil and sacrifice of the battlefield. Increasingly, we see evidence of a personal faith in God that was expressed in prayer, Bible reading, references to God in letters, proclamations, and speeches, as well as support for and service with many Christian organizations. The journalist Virgil Pinkley, who covered the war in North Africa and Europe as the UPI's senior correspondent in the theater, later wrote, "Wherever he was quartered or headquartered, I never saw Ike Eisenhower without a Bible somewhere in sight, on his desk, in a bookcase nearby, or on a table in his office. It was a Bible for use, as the well-worn pages showed." He not only prayed and read the Bible, but he encouraged others to do the same. At the first post-D-Day press conference on 8 June, an off-the-record affair, a tired Ike, no doubt bearing the burdens of stress and anxiety, discussed the events of the past 48 hours. He admitted the situation was still hazardous and cautioned the press not to present too rosy a picture. He stressed the critical importance of continued good weather, and he even told the reporters, "You fellows pray for it too." Each year from 1944 to 1952, we know that Eisenhower served on the National Layman Sponsoring Committee of the American Bible Society's Worldwide Bible Reading Program. His speeches in the immediate post-war years routinely stressed the critical importance of remembering the truth that man was created in the image of God. In his very first press conference as the new president at Columbia in mid-1948, a reporter stated that he understood that one of the prime qualifications of the man to be chosen as president of Columbia was that he be a religious man. And he then asked Eisenhower, "Do you feel that you qualify in that respect?" Eisenhower answered that he was, quote, "one of the most deeply religious men I know." Eisenhower's answer might strike many as being the kind of thing a truly spiritual person would not say. In fact, his own brother Edgar is reported to have stated, in reference to himself and his siblings, "All of us are religious, but we don't go around saying, I am a religious man, any more than we would say, I'm an honest man." Nevertheless, Eisenhower's reply can be viewed as a curious, but perhaps accurate answer to a very curious question, especially when understood in the light of his peculiar religious upbringing. It is also likely that Eisenhower, aware of how others saw and interpreted his irregular at best church attendance, as well as his lack of affiliation with an established denomination, felt a special desire to justify his religious faith, life. Nevertheless, he increasingly included religious and spiritual references in his talks. Though he did that, he did not immediately change his formal religious practices. Church attendance appears to have remained a relatively rare event for him prior to the presidency. In 1949, Eisenhower did accompany John D. Rockefeller Jr. to New York City's Riverside Church for Layman's Sunday, where he read Romans 12 during a service. However, he demonstrated his faith in other ways. In 1950, apparently at the invitation of General G.C.H. Cliff Lee, a famously religious colleague from World War II, he joined the Layman's Movement for a Christian World. That's a missionary organization. In 1951, while speaking at a Columbia engineering dinner, Eisenhower stressed the importance of continued dedication to the freedom of the individual and to his progress, spiritual, intellectual, and material, through all the means God has granted us. And in 1952, while still in Europe, Eisenhower wrote this in a private letter, "I am a serious and fervent Protestant and have been so throughout my career." Long before Eisenhower had begun his political career, his own words and actions showed evidence of real spiritual beliefs, though the particulars of his convictions remained private. But Eisenhower simply made too many references to God and to the importance of religion to justify dismissing his spiritual life as we seek to understand the man, his inner character, and the way his spiritual views informed his political beliefs and policies. In fact, as Merriman Smith, a senior White House correspondent, stated, in addition to his remarkably regular church attendance as president, a religious theme became a part of almost every public address. Regarding the role of God in his own life, Eisenhower once referenced, "The qualities and qualifications my God gave me to do my best for those I love and for myself, and in doing so, my best for my country." Regarding his own political views, he once said, "For my own part, in seeking some definition for the word democracy, I believe this one satisfied me more than any other. Democracy is the political expression of a deeply felt religion." This theme, along with his related assertions regarding the brotherhood of man under the fatherhood of God, formed the crucial intersection between Eisenhower's spiritual and political convictions. As mentioned above, many writers then and since have lampooned his famous assertion that our form of government has no sense unless it is founded in a deeply felt religious faith, and I don't care what it is. Taken in isolation from Eisenhower's many other religious and spiritual words and actions, this statement can appear vapid. But when placed in the context of his own religious experiences, it is a powerful claim to an admittedly ecumenical but nonetheless serious perspective that places religious truth at the foundation of American political life. In fact, the full context surrounding Eisenhower's statement makes this clear. In Eisenhower's address, he was comparing the differences between the American and Soviet systems and what a hopeless effort it had been to try and explain those differences to one of the Red Army's most senior leaders, Marshal Georgi Zhukov, since our form of government is founded on religion. He added that our ancestors who formed this government said, "We hold that all men are endowed by their creator, not by the accident of their birth, not by the color of their skins or by anything else, but all men are endowed by their creator." In other words, our form of government has no sense unless it is founded in a deeply felt religious faith, and I don't care what it is. Eisenhower then explained what he meant. With us, it is the Judeo-Christian concept, but it must be a religion that believes all men are created equal, even those among us who are, in my opinion, so silly as to doubt the existence of an Almighty, are still members of a religious civilization because the founding fathers said it was a religious concept that they were trying to translate into the political world. He reiterated this perspective while promoting the value of prayer in what became the first of the now famous annual National Prayer Breakfasts. Today, I think that prayer is just simply a necessity, because by prayer, I believe we mean an effort to get in touch with the infinite. We know that even our prayers are imperfect. Even our supplications are imperfect. Of course they are. We are imperfect human beings. But if we can back off from those problems and make the effort, then there is something that ties us all together. We have begun in our grasp of that basis of understanding, which is that all free government is firmly founded in a deeply felt religious faith. We know that he took the power of prayer seriously, not only because he regularly referred to it and was reported to have resorted to it habitually, but because he shocked the entire nation by deciding to begin his first inaugural address with what he called a little private prayer that he had just written on hotel stationery that morning. It was the first time any president in American history had begun an inaugural address by leading the country in prayer. Perhaps the most astonishing statement about Eisenhower's spiritual convictions was disclosed by Billy Graham to Reverend Elson in a lengthy private letter written on the day prior to the inauguration. In that letter, Graham explained Eisenhower's recent religious practices and beliefs to include Ike's admission that while in the Army, he very rarely went to chapel. However, Eisenhower's explanation for this apparent breach of Christian devotion was not apathy, but rather disappointment and dissatisfaction with the religious services available to him. Whether this represents the whole truth or just a rationalization is open to debate. Graham concluded from their private conversations that Eisenhower had lost confidence in the church because it had gone into socialism. The church had left the Bible and had gone into politics and other things that it had no business to be delving in. Eisenhower told him that he had sampled several churches some years ago, but found very little in the sermons of any of the preachers that were of spiritual help to him. Eisenhower confessed to Graham that if he identified with any church, he would be a fanatical Protestant. Graham then related what he himself admitted was a very remarkable statement made just the week prior by the president-elect. The American people will have to get back to biblical Christianity, and I intend to lead them. Unsurprisingly, considering the details of their private conversations, Graham told Elson that, despite Eisenhower's lack of church going, I believe he is a deeply religious man. When the full story of Eisenhower's spiritual journey is told, I believe the evidence will confirm Graham's conclusions. My assessment that Eisenhower was a more seriously religious and deeply spiritual man, and specifically a practicing Orthodox Protestant Christian at that, is supported by the testimonies of many family, friends, and colleagues, ranging from his lifelong wife, Mamie, to his dear grandson, David, to various journalists who covered him during World War II and his presidency, to his pastors in Washington, D.C., Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and Palm Desert, California, to Billy Graham, and to a wide range of colleagues and associates. That said, I have to admit that Eisenhower appears to have been a particular kind of Christian, the kind that made it difficult for scholars to determine what he personally thought about a wide range of interesting and important doctrinal issues. One of the reasons contemporaries and scholars alike have been so willing to question the veracity of his faith and the sincerity of his public religiosity is that he so rarely, in public or in private, addressed deep theological issues with sufficient specificity to satisfy the curious. Despite his regular references to God, the Bible, and prayer, he hardly ever spoke or wrote of Jesus, or indeed, about any particularly Christian doctrines. One contemporary writer described Eisenhower as having a very fervent faith and a very vague religion. While he engaged with Billy Graham over a period of many years, it appears that he never attended one of Graham's crusades, despite repeated invitations from Graham and some that approached urgent personal pleas. While these questions can be frustrating, I don't believe their existence warrants dismissing all that we do know about him. It would probably be naive to believe that every person's, and especially every politician's, religious words and deeds should be taken at face value all the time. However, based on the weight of the evidence, Eisenhower really does appear to have had a deeply felt religious faith that manifested itself in varying ways in different periods of his life, was an increasingly important component of his character and worldview, and remains an essential element of his personality that should be taken into account in any serious attempt to understand the man and his accomplishments. Late in life, Dwight Eisenhower wrote a little essay on his simple but strong faith and his regular reliance on prayer. It was published just after his death in the spring of 1969. He wrote, "A lifetime of soldiering and public service, only confirms my conviction that I am as intensely religious as any man I know. Nobody goes through 6 years of war and 2 terms of the presidency without faith. And although I have seldom discussed my religious philosophy with anyone, a deep Bible-centered Christian faith has colored my life since childhood. While we might quibble with the assertion that nobody could possibly go through 6 years of war and 2 terms of the presidency without a serious faith in God, the evidence suggests that we can and should take Eisenhower at his word about his own spiritual life. Dwight Eisenhower was a deeply religious man, a Bible-centered Christian, and that, along with his God's good providence, explains his greatness in war and in peace. It's long past time for a more accurate perspective on the reality and importance of Eisenhower's spiritual life to be incorporated fully into both the scholarly as well as the popular understanding of his life, his achievements, and his character. Thank you. And I look forward to hearing your thoughts in the Q&A period to follow.
Okay, thank you so much. What an amazing address you gave us. We really appreciate it. My name is Greg Moore. I'm a professor of global studies and politics, and I'm going to help field some questions. As it says up there on the screen, if anybody has questions who's watching online, you can send questions to the email address right up there on the screen, questions@ccu.edu. Anybody here in the room have questions? Just raise your hand, and our faithful student Alex will run over to you with expedition and bring a microphone so we can hear you. So anyone here have questions?
I'm just curious what sparked your interest in kind of diving into Eisenhower's history.
Yeah, that's a great question, because anybody who would look at my, what we academics call our CV, you know, our resume, would look like I've been doing a bunch of other things. I'm a military historian, an American military historian who is focused mostly on the First World War. And as I told you, Eisenhower didn't even get to France in the First World War. It almost broke his, it apparently didn't ruin his career as he expected. But he managed to overcome it. But I had not been a scholar of Eisenhower's life until a few years ago when I in a failed job interview process, I didn't get the job, but I did get a book offer. So someone else asked me whether I would be willing to write a spiritual biography of either George C. Marshall, who you met in this talk, or Dwight Eisenhower. And at that time, I knew that George Marshall was a devout Episcopalian. I didn't know, in fact, what I knew about Eisenhower matched all the wrong ideas that I said. I remember from my own graduate program, I remember being told, yeah, Eisenhower didn't even know what religion he was when he became president. Well, depending on what you mean by that question, that's true. So anyway, I was kind of introduced to it by an offer to explore this, and thankfully, I work in Colorado, and Eisenhower's papers are in Abilene, Kansas. That's where his professional, or his presidential museum and library are. It's a great trip, just a few hours east of us here, off of I-70, and so I had this offer to look into either George Marshall or Dwight Eisenhower. I knew them as military men. I didn't know much about their private lives other than what other scholars had written about it, which now you know is not necessarily the full story. So I, since I'm closer to Abilene, Kansas than I am to Marshall's papers in Virginia, I took a few trips out to Abilene, Kansas and went through the papers. And frankly, I was astounded at all of his religious talk and his activity. So that's what piqued my interest. Someone else suggested I look into it, and I was curious enough. I've always been interested in him as an important, perhaps even great general, and as an important, perhaps even great president. And I do believe it's important that we not only look at the religious lives of religious people, like Billy Graham, right? It's important to know the religious lives and the spiritual views of people who excel in other fields, whether that's law or medicine or politics or academia, et cetera. So that's how I got into this.
Great question. Great question. Do we have some other questions? Got a couple.
Yeah. There you go. Do you think that many people have probably tried to hide Eisenhower's faith because of a general trend away from evangelicalism and Christianity in general?
So, it's a good question. I have my suspicions. I don't want to paint with too broad a brush. I suspect we're talking about so many writers, historians, political scientists, journalists writing about this over such a long period of time. Some of them may very well have come across things and decided to purposefully minimize it. That's possible. I suspect, though, that perhaps people who themselves are not religious might not know what to make of his religiosity. And if you just look at it superficially, here's a guy who wasn't going to church. He's going to become president. He gets baptized. He starts going to church. I mean, if you look at it superficially, it could look like he's instrumentalizing religion, right? And so people have taken that view. But the curious thing with historical scholarship is that when good, even great historians lay out a certain line, that sort of line gets picked up by other people, right? And many of the people who I think have mischaracterized or minimized his faith are fantastic historians in most ways, but I think they've gotten this part wrong. And so I want to be careful about saying they've purposefully hidden it, though that's, of course, possible. I think they've probably missed it. They don't know what to make of it. I think also lack of interest. They're just not interested. Like, why would it matter if he was or he wasn't? Religious people of varying denominations and religions are interested in that sort of a thing for a variety of reasons.
Good answer. Another question? Nicole, did you? Oh, okay. Any other questions? Well, I have a question. I was curious if you came across the answer to this question in your research. Why do you think he got baptized? Do you think he acquired some kind of born-again theology, perhaps?
I don't have the answer to that yet. What we do know, I mentioned this a few moments ago, that when people were thinking of him as a candidate, they immediately noticed in a more religious America than we have today, he didn't appear to be overtly and obviously religious, and people who really wanted him to become president thought this would be a liability. In fact, some of his big political backers, I've seen the letter written by a wealthy backer, and it was interesting the way the author of the letter wrote it. He didn't say, I think this. He said, my wife, the women, right? My wife and her friends, they say, or they know people, that they would never vote. This is from the Bible Belt, okay, the 1950s Bible Belt. They would never vote for someone who's not a churchgoer. Right? So this is what the kind of stuff that's given to him. And he, of course, he just won't touch that with a 10-foot pole. He's a person of integrity. If there was a time to do it, you'd do it early, right? Not after you get, he wasn't even sure he was going to run for a second term. When he left office, after a second term, he was the oldest president to leave office. So I don't think he did it for any political reasons. But Billy Graham was one of those who encouraged him to join a church. I've never seen any votes comments to it. Of course Billy Graham's gonna suggest he go to church, right? If Billy Graham had met any of you and he found you were a Christian who weren't going to church, Billy Graham would have said, you gotta find a good church, right? So one of the interesting things that Billy Graham reports is that Eisenhower had told him, I will not join a church during a campaign, but I will commit to you that I will join a church, win or lose. And then, after he was president-elect, he asked Billy Graham, who kind of helped with his campaign in a certain way, that's an interesting story in and of itself, he asked him for some recommendations of solid churches in Washington, D.C., and Mamie was raised a Presbyterian right here in Denver, and he said, you know, when I would go to church with Mamie, you know, she's Presbyterian, so I would do that. Do you know any good Presbyterian churches? And I suspect that when he got linked up with that Presbyterian minister, who had been a World War II Army chaplain in Eisenhower's theater, so he certainly knew Eisenhower, whether Eisenhower knew him is maybe a point that hasn't been firmly established yet. But I think Reverend Elson explained to him what was required. And this is why I think his baptism to me is a very important thing, because there's no reason, if he just wanted to kind of lead by example, no one was going to stop him from going to church. Eisenhower could have gone to any number of churches, he could have bounced around, but something I think happened, I'm not sure, I don't think I want to call it a conversion, because Eisenhower didn't believe he was converted. I think he came to a different view about what the Christian life sort of demanded. And again, if we think about his Mennonite background, the important thing was not going to church. This is the radical Protestant. The important thing was Bible reading and prayer and other things like that. But clearly something changed in there. And I think some of it may have been, hey, I'm a Christian. I am the leader of these people. And to get to a point we were talking about during dinner, the great geopolitical struggle at the time is between an avowedly godless, materialist Soviet system. They weren't secular. They were anti-religion. Just ask anybody in the Russian Orthodox Church, after 1918. They were anti-religion. And so I think he thought that the right thing for him to do was to be the very best kind of Christian he could be. And that example was important. But I go to church, perhaps in part, to set an example for my children. But that's not the only reason I go, but that's a good one. I want them to know that this is how a Christian ought to behave. And I think he kind of picked up on that in 1952, 53, and also his growing appreciation for his Christian faith that appears to have come through the horrors of World War II, where he really saw good and evil, and he saw systems that saw humanity as not made in the image of God. Right, the Nazi systems, the Japanese systems, and then after that the Soviet systems, so that this was a crucial part of his political view.
Can I ask a follow-up question to that?
Apparently.
Well, let me see. Anybody else have any other questions here? Anybody? Don't be bashful. Oh, Nicole's coming.
Have you researched any evidence of other people, whether in the military or in the White House that he was around, that were also becoming believers at this time? Or was it something he was kind of pursuing on his own?
Yeah, I certainly haven't looked around to see if other people were having this sort of experience. I'm sure that other people had their religious life changed during World War II, some for the better and some for the worse. We know that happened in World War I. How could a good God let this happen, whether it was the death of their brother, the death of their son, the death of their buddies? So people come through those searing experiences of wars often going one way or the other. Holocaust victims, and Eisenhower saw the remains of the Holocaust with his own eyes in 1945 as his forces were liberating concentration camps. He was brought in to see this, and calling back to the U.S. shouldn't do this. I don't think he had a phone in his hand, but we need to send reporters and journalists and congressmen. Everybody needs to see what's going on here. And I think some people have those searing experiences with evil, and they can't deal with it theologically, and they go one way. And my suspicion is that with Eisenhower, it reinforced his views about good and evil, a world without God, that sort of a thing. But I haven't seen specific examples about other senior officers that came through the war with that kind of a changed view. I would imagine it happened.
Good question. We still have time, if Mark will humor us for a few more minutes. We have time for more questions. So again, if you're watching via Zoom or YouTube and you have a question, you can email it to questions@ccu.edu, or question, no S, just question@ccu.edu. Anyone else here have a question?
So in your research, what can you tell us about his personal relationship with God? Like, was there any personal prayers that he had, or speeches maybe that he gave where he said something specific about God and how he, because you also said that theologically, you know, he didn't have much to say. So I just wanted to know maybe what his own interpretation of God was.
Yeah. I'm not done with the research yet. The papers that he generated are voluminous, as you can imagine. So I'm sure there is a lot more to be found. What I've never seen any direct evidence of are sort of, we might say, well, what are his views on the divinity of Jesus, right? You know, specific, or talk to me about the Trinity or other kinds of things. Did he really wrestle with theodicy? And I haven't seen that. He doesn't appear, and this is confirmed by the oral interviews of his pastors, that he didn't appear to be overly troubled by theological questions. Some of us are, and some of us aren't, right? So we're kind of the way we're wired. His pastor at Gettysburg said, you know, that he had a kind of a simple but a solid faith. And thankfully, we know what he had to profess in order to be baptized in that Presbyterian church. And it is an Orthodox Christian statement of, you know, my own sinfulness, and Jesus is my Savior, and I wish I had written that quote down, because I've literally seen the duplicate of his baptismal certificate, which is in Abilene, and it kind of goes through all that. As for his kind of private prayer life, that's a really hard thing, unless someone keeps a prayer journal, to capture. You know, I grew up in a religious family. My brothers are also religious. I thought if I was trying to prove that, you know, the deep questions of their theology, what could I find in their letters and their emails? Think about your own life or people that you know. It's a difficult thing to get at. What we do get is rather simple, and I don't say that as an insult. He clearly viewed God as being in control of events, and that prayers to God were important. They were an important consolation for him. He talked about not having the courage to make the decisions that he had to make. I mean, dealing with thousands of lives on any given day without knowing that there was a loving God in heaven that was supervising all human events. But there are more questions than answers the deeper we get into Christian theology with him.
I have one question from from an online viewer named Paul, and he's asking, did Billy Graham ever write or opine on Eisenhower's faith or his Ike's relationship with God? Billy Graham's written a lot, and I'm just wondering if Billy Graham said much.
He did. I quoted some of Billy Graham's statements. There are those fascinating letters that Billy Graham wrote to Reverend Elson, who was just kind of on the verge of becoming Eisenhower's pastor. fact, Billy Graham developed a good relationship with the family. Billy Graham visited Eisenhower on his deathbed, and as I mentioned this, he not only wrote about that, but he spoke about it. You can YouTube Billy Graham. There's a lot of Billy Graham sermons or talks on the internet, and you can find him talking about Eisenhower. In fact, on the 100th centennial of Eisenhower's birthday, or birth year, so in 1990, because Eisenhower was born in 1890, in 1990 they had a big ceremony in Abilene, Kansas, as you'd imagine, and Billy Graham was one of the speakers. And in that talk, he says, I asked Mamie if I could tell this story, and she said it was okay. And that story is when he visited Eisenhower after one of his last heart attacks. He was had all sorts of medical trouble. He was in the hospital bed for months in Washington, D.C., and Billy Graham came to visit him. And he did write about their conversation, and it was a very honest conversation about, can you tell me again how a sinner gets saved? And Billy Graham says, I went pulled out my Bible and went through, you know, this is how we know a person go to heaven, and they step through it and they pray. He said, we held hands, we prayed together, I think they read a psalm, and Eisenhower said, thank you, I'm ready now. So we do know some of their interactions. Billy Graham wrote to Eisenhower a lot more than Eisenhower wrote to him. But I suppose that's true with most people who are engaging with the president, who's pretty busy. Though Billy Graham was a pretty busy guy himself too. So they appear to have a very positive relationship. Okay, we'll trade places.
Professor Grotlucian, that was just wonderful. Thank you very much for that. Let's give him another round of applause. That was just great. We wish you God's blessing on your book. I imagine knowing our president, Dr. Donald Sweeting, who loves history, that book will be waiting on my desk the minute it's published as a gift from him. He often gives books to his cabinet, to members of the Board of Trustees, and I imagine you will be very high on his list. So we'll be looking forward to that, and we wish God's blessing upon you on that. A few quick announcements. From the Centennial Institute, these are kind of famous 1776 ties and 1776 scarves. On any given day, you can find these somewhere on cable news television as a result of many of the speakers we've hosted here. We want to give these to you and to your wife, and thank you for coming out here. Friends, there is another President's Lecture coming up this spring, April 12th, 2021. We'll be hosting Dr. Douglas Grotius, a great friend of the university from Denver Seminary. He'll be giving his talk on morphing Marxism, still a bad idea. So I hope you'll join us when Dr. Sweeting will be back for the next President's Lecture. Until then, God bless you all. Have a wonderful evening. Good night.